So welcome to this course again. So we are going to start a new topic today. It's actually on surface characterization techniques. As you know, there are many surface characterization techniques, and in this course we are going to talk about some of the advanced surface characterization techniques. Simple surface characterization techniques involves measurement of composition of the surface of any material, or even measurement of the oxygen concentration or nitrogen concentration which are present on any surface of the material. In case of material science, they are very important, because we know most of the things start happening at the surface. So therefore, surface needs to be fully characterized. Not even that, the best example of surface effect on the material behavior is in catalysis. As we know, the catalytic reactions take place at the surface. So therefore, surface structure, surface composition, even the atomic electronic state of the atoms at the surface do play a tremendous role in catalysis. So therefore, surface is studied extensively, and because of advent of new techniques, surface characterization has become very important. In this about 9 lectures which I am going to take, obviously we cannot discuss everything of surface characterization. We have to limit ourselves because of time constraint. I am going to discuss several important aspects, but before that, let me just give you the reference books. The first reference books is very important. It's called ESCA, Modern ESCA Principles and Practice of X-ray Photoelectric Spectroscopy. This is by Tony Terrible. It's published by CRC Space. And this one, the next one, is Encyclopedia of Material Characterization, editors by the Bundle and Evans. They are Wilson, published by Butterworth Henman, Boston. It's also very important book where you can get all the informations. There are many other books available in the literature which you can refer, or even there is a lot of information available on internet, so you can also look at it. So the way outline of this particular chapter or particular portion of the course is made is like this. First, I am going to talk, today I am going to talk about importance of the surface characterization techniques. Why do you need surface characterization techniques? This is what we are going to talk today, and then I will talk about other techniques which are involved. First one is the X-ray photoelectron spectroscopy, second one is the Auger electron spectroscopy, and the last one is called secondary ion mass spectroscopy. So XPS is what is called X-ray photoelectron spectroscopy, AES what is called Auger electron spectroscopy, and SIMS what is called secondary ion mass spectroscopy. These three techniques will be detailed in this course. Finally, I am going to compare this surface analysis technique so that you can get an idea which technique has advantage in certain aspects over the others. Well, before I go into the detail of these techniques, obviously it is very important to know why do you need to use surface characterization techniques that too advanced. You know, when in our labs technique facilities are available, we start using it extensively, but that's not the way to do. We need to understand that we need to have information regarding the scientific investigation of any kind of activity on material science. That means whether a technique can be used to divulge scientific information to understand certain phenomena. That's why actually the importance and applicability of the particular technique, experimental technique, comes into picture. And one need to really understand it. As the course goes on, probably you are getting and feeling that there are a lot of techniques, we are talking about it, which technique we need to use for what kind of applications is not dealt with. Well, that's what actually I am planning to do it at the end of the course. I will go to give you some examples where a set of techniques are used and a scientific understanding of the phenomena going on during a materials processing and application will be talked about it. This one I am going to talk about for copper lead alloys, most importantly the copper lead powder metallurgy alloys, which actually I have talked about this in the first lecture of this course. You know that these alloys are used for bearing applications, so therefore there are certain aspects of microstructure which we need to have in the applications. So most importantly we need to have a duplex microstructure with a homogeneous distribution of softer phase in a hard phase or hard matrix, and therefore hard matrix will resist the wear and softer matrix will act as a lubricant, and that is so actually used in the bearing applications. And most common technique which is used to produce copper lead alloys is by casting route, but as you know lead is heavier than copper, much heavier than copper. So if you want to do casting, lead will segregate and create inhomogeneous distribution of lead in the microstructure, and obviously coarse distribution will happen because of the microsegregation, and this is bad. So therefore casting techniques cannot be used for preparation of this bearing alloys, we need to use some other technique. So then people tried with powder metallurgy route, where you mix copper and lead very nicely and then make a gin pellet, sinter it. But if you do sinter normal atmosphere, a problem is oxidation first of all, because in pressureless sintering, those of you know about pressureless sintering, you just put inside a furnace for a long time at high temperatures, about 600 to 700 Celsius temperature, to sinter it to the optimum density, about 90-95% of theoretical density. You start increasing the copper grain size and also start creating the problem of oxidation. So conventional sintering has this problem of extensive grain growth and oxidation, and this leads to inferior properties. So what is the solution? Not only that, nowadays people talk about a lot of things about nanocrystalline alloys, they have excellent properties. In fact copper is one such material, while nanocrystalline grains of copper can give very high hardness, very high strength. At the same time it can also, you know, impart lot of other advantages in bearing alloys. So that is why actually we started looking at nanocrystalline copper lead alloys. In fact this is a part of our own research activities, one of my own students have done this work, and we have used FSL sintering technique called splash plasma sintering to produce this kind of microstructures. As you see here, this is a copper 10 weight percent lead, copper 12 weight percent lead, and copper 15 weight percent lead. One can go on increase, but then what will happen is after a certain time the lead will be agglomerated and distribution will not be proper. What you see here is that lead is uniformly distributed in the microstructure. There are few pores present, obviously that is a problem of any powder metallurgy product, but to understand whether we are able to produce nanocrystalline grains or not, written, this is what the TM picture, you can see here these grains actually copper, and they are of the order of 80 to 100 nanometers or maybe little bit higher than 100 nanometers. The diffraction pattern is taken from one such copper grain, this is a micro diffraction pattern taken from one such copper grain, showing it is a copper not oxide. And you have lead sitting like this, and one as a lenticular lead between the two grains or at the grain junction points, triple junction points, this is where the lead sits. So therefore it is possible to retain the nanocrystalline copper grains at the same time, distribute the lead in a very nice manner. And this kind of microstructures which is shown here is a good candidate for study wear. So we need to do that, and that is what is done. Because bearing application means wear and tear, so wear needs to be studied. So once you do this wear for different lead concentration, 12.5, 15, and this is also 12.5, as you see, no, I guess this is 10, sorry, this is 10, 12.5 and 15. So this is 10 weight percent lead, this is 15 weight percent lead, this is 12.5 weight percent lead. So if you look at the coefficient of friction values, this is done in fitting wear, because fitting is more severe than sliding wear, and most of bearings actually undergo kind of fitting wear. So that is why you want to do it in a normal atmosphere, because that is what actually they are applied. And this you could see the coefficient of friction for fitting cycles up to 100,000, it remains constant for most of the cases, close to 0.4. This is again steel ball, this wire test has been done. So, the fretting ball is steel. As we know, the coefficient of friction between copper and steel is actually, against steel is actually 0.78, 0.8, almost close to. So, therefore, we are able to reduce the coefficient of friction extensively. That is the biggest advantage of applying lead. Lead acts as a lubricant and reduces this. So, but what does actually happen in the oxidation in the wire phenomena is not clear now. We only see the friction of coefficient. Now, if we look at the wire surface, then comes the picture, things become clearer. Here I am showing you the uses of scanning electron microscope. As you see here, this is the own area. You can see lot of cracks, fissures, and you can even see delamination, formation of tribal layer. And if you take the wire debris, you could see the oxygen present, lead is present there, you can see white color, and copper is present in a delaminated form. So, that is what I have seen. This is when the sinter 350 and load was 55 Newton. Now, it does not even tell you what is happening in the wire process. If you do a Raman spectroscopy, that is where actually spectroscopic techniques comes into picture. I have shown you Raman's, discuss about Raman spectroscopy. If you use Raman spectroscopy, you started saying lot of oxides presence, and this tells us actually the what is called state of atoms. You have seen iron oxide, copper oxide. Iron is coming from steel ball, lead oxides. Now, lead has different kind of oxides, PbO, Pb3O4. Well, although it gives you very nice signals, very broad signals in Raman spectroscopy of the oxides, but that may not be sufficient enough to really pinpoint what kind of lead oxides present. That is, what is this electronic state of the lead and oxygen is not clear. That can only be done if you use XPS, that is X-ray photoelectron spectroscopy. And that is done here. As you can see here very clearly, this is the state of the lead of the one such particles on the own surface. And this is the energy level, binding energy. This basically XPS is plotted between intensity and binding energy. This can be easily fitted with lead 4F state. And in fact, I am not going to talk about it, can be even done better, which I will discuss you detail when I do XPS analysis, XPS discussion. And oxygen is 1S state. So, therefore, it is PbO, not PbO3O4. That can be confirmed. So, one can actually keep on understand, one can use actually these techniques to make the understanding of the whole process very clear. That is what has been done. To understand the wear mechanism of this nanocrystalline copper lead alloys, we need to use these spectroscopic techniques, both surface characterization, surface advanced characterization techniques, and also bulk to know what is happening there. So, it is an oxidative wire which do takes place in the copper lead alloys when you use in normal atmospheric pressure. Now, detail of these works are published now, one can look at literature from our group, but obviously oxidation means a host of oxides, lead oxide, iron oxide, copper oxides, they are very hard. So, what is the actual effect of that, of this oxidized oxides on the wear behavior is very interesting thing. So, you understand that if I use this oxides and oxides are present in a bearing alloy, they are loose, but they will be hard. So, they will basically abrade the counter interface more easily. That is one example. Second example is again from our own work, one of my PhD students work is HAP titanium composites, which are used for medical applications, basically for orthopedic applications. HAP is hydroxyapatite, for your information. Hydroxyapatite is the bone, it's a constituent of the chemical constituents of the bone, the inorganic constituents of the bone. So, therefore, most of the biomedical applications requires development of new materials. One such material which is important for both dental and the bone application is hydroxyapatite based. And hydroxyapatite is a noble material in the sense that it allows, is basically biocompatible and bioactive. That means, once it goes in the body, it allows the cells to grow on it and helps the self regeneration process and many other things. So, but there is a problem, hydroxyapatite is very brittle, its fracture toughness is 0.K1C is basically 0.5 MPa root meter, which is very low. Normal bone has a fracture toughness between 2 to 12, cortical bones actually, MP rudimentary. So it is very, you know, much lower than what is to be expected. So there is always research activity to improve its fracture toughness or mechanical behavior properties, so that it can be used for load bearing application like bones or even teeth, because in your teeth you are applying a lot of forces to chew your food. So what to do? You add a metal, and you cannot add all metals, so people add titanium. Titanium is a biocompatible but bioinert, and it is having high corrosion resistance, as you know. So if you add titanium, titanium gets distributed like this, here shown. These are the titanium and hydroxyapatite grains. So once you put this hydroxyapatite titanium composites inside your body, it comes in contact with the body fluid, and as you go on doing our daily activities, it undergoes wear and tear. So one is to understand what happens to your wear behavior under such conditions. So what people do normally is to study the wear behavior in simulated body fluids. Simulated body fluids have almost similar composition that of the body fluid, and then we do this fetting wear there. As you can see here, the under different conditions, wet and dry, pure hydroxyapatite and hydroxyapatite 10 Ti, the coefficient friction behaviors are given. This is again published literature, it is under publication, so there is no problem. So as you can see here, if you use wet conditions, you have lower value of coefficient frictions. Basically we add certain proteins also here, albumin, to create more likely situation when in physiological situations, and coefficient friction values varies from 0.3 to 0.6 depending on the material, depending on the kind of wet or dry conditions. And if you look at the wear rate, it is also pretty low. You can see here the wear rate under dry and wet condition is reduced substantially. So that means these materials will be able to do better job inside the body. But what is the mechanism of wear? That is what one is to understand. So if you look at this again, the morphology of bone surfaces for pure HA dry and pure HA wet, I am showing you can see the delaminated layers and breakage of that. Not only that, if you look at morphology more closely, you can see this. Some of the cases you can see the apatite crystal forming on the surface, and they help in reducing the wear. If you look at 10 Ti, you can see even delaminated layers, but you also see the small particles presence other than titanium. These are titanium big ones, small particles presence there, here, okay. They are actually apatite crystals which forms when this materials comes in contact with the simulated body fluids, and they are good because their apatite, they are good for the body, they are good for many things. So they actually start interacting with it, with the own, you know, counter body, and that is how actually where behavior changes. To understand it more, we have done actually this morphology of wire. This is actually EDAX mapping. I have already showed you the inactivity dispersed spectroscopy mapping is possible. If you map it, these are the titaniums, and these are the actually hydroxyapatite. But you started seeing this kind of crystals, this kind of crystals which are basically apatite crystals which form because of the interaction with the simulated body fluids. So we can see the formation of apatite crystals also in underlying cracking. Now once you take this kind of material and do the XPS after wear own surface, you started seeing this calcium 2 states which are a signature of two different compounds. So one is hydroxyapatite, other one is the apatite which is present. You will also see the carbon peaks, obviously the carbon will present because you have added a lot of solutions. Then phosphorus 2S and phosphorus 2P peaks, oxygen is abundantly present. Okay, you actually see a titanium peak but not very clear. So therefore, the presence of apatite crystals are very clear by doing this SPS. As I have been telling you, this crystal actually upon formed during this process of wear changes the wear mechanism much, because it is forming a layer on the surface of the material, and then the contact between the counter body and the surface is no longer there, new contact develops, and that is how wear behavior changes. So using these kind of techniques, one can really understand the actual insight, actual scientific phenomena. Actually, one can go into the details of a scientific phenomena which is there. These are normally not done routinely, but if you really want to do scientific understanding of any process, that's why actually you need to understand these characters and techniques, you need to use it. Many labs actually have, in fact, IIT Kanpur is also going to get XPS very soon, and it's available routinely, so one can do that. Well, the third example which I'm going to give is from my own PhD work, that is on iron germanium 25% germanium laser ablated thin films. You know, thin films are actually routinely used many applications. We wanted to understand, if I take iron 25% germanium alloy and from a thin film by laser ablation, which is very well known technique, what kind of structure develop. As you see here, these are all very high resolution pictures, transmission electron pictures. The reason actually I am bringing you all these things is that I have already taught you high resolution transmission electron microscopy, various spectroscopic techniques, and I want to bring them together and make you that this, you know, why we need to use surface characterization techniques to decipher the scientific insights of these processes or these structures. As you can clearly see, we see clusters. You see this kind of clusters, well ordered clusters inside these thin films when they are as deposited conditions. Well, detailed conditions all will be available in the literature, you can search, but that is not the issue. What you see here is this well ordered structure, you can see this one also. They are not atoms, remember, they are clusters of atoms. That is what is very important to note. And if you do the diffraction analysis, you see broad rings, signature of amorphous structure. That is what happens if you take any kind of alloy, started doing a laser ablations, most of the cases you started forming an amorphous thin films. Now, this thin films which you deposit on the surface, they needs to be thermal, you know, as a function of temperature, also as a function of, you know, compositions. Then only they can be used for applications, because real applications temperature may increase. So what do people need to study, and the thermal response on these thin films? And that is very important in the sense that, you know, these amorphous structures are normally considered to be not stable. So they are actually prone to get transformed into crystalline forms. So to do that actually, and this is in a better high resolution picture, and in fact one can actually do this using a modern electron microscope, TEMs, and you can see here some kind of this kind of clusters present there. I do not know whether you can see, you will be able to see there. And these clusters actually are, you know, we can take actually nano diffraction pattern, that means we can take a nano beam and put it there and gather diffraction pattern, that is what is done here. If you do that, we started seeing diffraction spots here, you can see, and this diffraction spot D values are written. If you look at that, they are very close to RN, which is your RN, okay, 1.45 and Armstrong is basically close to 200 plane spacing of BCC RN, and 2.003 is basically 1 on 0. So that means we can actually see this clusters actually pure RN type. They are not actually pure RN, but some kind of solution between BCC RN with germanium. Germanium is there. So things will be very clear once I started showing these pictures. This is actually in situ heating microscopic. These thin films, if I put inside a heating holder in a transmission electron microscope and then heat it inside the microscope and observe it during this heating, that is what is actually done here. So you take this thin films and then heat it up. Once you heat it up inside the microscope, you will start seeing changes. So that is what you see here. You see this is getting changed to this, and finally from 300K to 773K you started forming crystalline things, and you can see from the diffraction pattern itself actually you started forming this thin crystal, this black regions of crystals signifying this ring, weak ring in the diffraction pattern, and is fully getting transformed at 773K. If you do it careful diffraction analysis, okay, if you are a good electron microscope you can do that, and you also have to have a good electron microscopes. Then you can see these grains which are there, they are actually order, they are actually DOT order structure, let us not get into that. And they have B2 domains and also DO3 moments. This is B2, this is DO3 domains presence. So that means they have got order at solid state, and therefore you can see these two ordered domains. Now first of all, that means we are starting forming, when you heat treat it, we crystallize as BCC iron. BCC actually solution of germanium in iron, and that gets ordered later on to form B2, and further ordering leads to DO3 structure. So your nucleating phase is basically BCC solution of iron. Why does it happen? Does the thin film has this clusters presence which I have been indicating you? Well, diffraction analysis do suggest this kind of clusters presence, but no conclusive evidence. This is all, you know, kind of one spot coming and then we are saying that. So what we can do? We can actually do a mass spectroscopy of this, you know, clusters during the deposition of thin film. That is called in-flight mass spectroscopy. And this in-flight mass spectroscopy will tell us what kind of mass is present. This is nothing but intensity versus mass in atomic mass unit. Okay, you would see large error bars, that is okay for FEDC. In fact, the most intense peak is 240, that corresponds to that FEG, you know, clusters which are present there. So this confirms actually our thought process, our experimental, you know, thought, whatever happening in the experiments, whatever you are thinking or whatever contemplating, it proves. And that helps us in publishing this paper also. So I am just telling you that by using this surface characterization techniques, or the techniques which will allow us to study the, you know, surfaces, is basically giving us scientific insight into the problems. There are a host of examples one can talk. Actually, I can keep on talking about it. That's not the way, because there are time limitations of that also. So I am just going to show you a few examples, and these are the things which you will do in your research activities, where you need to understand the scientific process happening, so that you can actually bring about the, you know, process control later on, and that is why these are used. Now let me just get into some of these things in the today's class. You know, basically the most important technique, surface characterization techniques used, is called XPS, X-ray photo electron spectroscopy. It comes from Einstein's discovery. In 1921, he got Nobel Prize for that, a photoelectric effect. What is it? Well, this is what is shown in this picture here. If I have X-ray photons, okay, X-ray photon has energy h nu, nu is the frequency, h is the Planck constant. It falls, allowed to fall on an oxygen atom. What is going to do? It has a very high energy. It is going to knock out an electron from the inner cell, 1s cell. 1s cell had 2 electrons. It is going to knock out 1 electron, and this electron comes out. Now this electron has a specific energy. Obviously, it has been knocked out from this cell because the X-rays which has fallen on this has high energy, higher than the binding energy to the electron. Otherwise, it cannot knock out. So it has been knocked out, and also it has been given certain kinetic energy. So h nu must be equal to the binding energy of the electron plus the kinetic energy, right? That is what is actually the energy balance. So now if I know the kinetic energy, obviously I know h nu, because I know what is the wavelength of the X-ray radiation. So I can calculate the binding energy. And as you know, the binding energy of an electron in any atom is very fixed. It will vary from one element to other element. If you take nitrogen, binding energy of 1s electron will be different from the oxygen. So by using the, by measuring the binding energy, I can exactly say what kind of element is present, what is state, electronic state of electron. Whether this is coming from 1s cell, 2s cell or 2p cell, I can tell that also. Not only that, one can actually tell even the spin of the electrons which is present. That is why there is a 2p 1/3, 2p 2p 1 by 2 or 2p 3 by 2, one can tell what kind of spin it has. So this is what actually is a major discovery done by Kai Segbon in 1981, he got Nobel Prize for this, you must not forget. So the concept of Einstein for photoelectrons has been used by Sigmund for a basic principle, and which I am going to discuss in detail about that. So XPS, what is known as ESCA, is now the most widely used surface analysis technique because of its relative simplicity in use in the data interpretation. I have already discussed what it. There are various versions of XPS. First one is XPS, second one is ESCA, electron spectroscopy for chemical analysis. The principles are same. Third one is ultraviolet photoelectron spectroscopy. Instead of X-ray, you can use ultraviolet ray. And last one is called PES, photo emission spectroscopy. You can use a light to emit electron. That is called photo emission. So nevertheless, light is nothing but laser beam. Helium neon laser can be used to, or any other laser actually, which wavelength comes in the light. In the visible range can be used. So there are a host of techniques. The most important ones are these two, which we are going to discuss in detail. Well, again, to tell you details of that, okay, because we are starting off, as I have discussed, this is what is going to happen. Kinetic energy of electron is going to be h nu minus Eb plus phi. Phi is the work function. Well, to modify it, so therefore, this is the suppose binding energy. This is 1s, 2s, 2p, 3s electrons. And suppose a photon comes in terms of X-ray or in terms of ultraviolet or in terms of light photon, and then it emits, it ejects an electron from this 2p cell, and this will become a photoelectron. So it has to go above the Fermi level, and then if it has more energy, higher energy than the work function, it will go even above the vacuum. So that is why actually is written Ke, kinetic energy of that electron, is h nu minus this, you know, the binding energy of the electron plus phi. So if you know this Ke, we can calculate what is the binding energy. XPS spectrum actually basically nothing but intensity of photoelectron versus Eb or Ke. We can either plot Eb or Kb, Ke versus the, sorry, this should be wrong, this is Eb or Ke versus intensity. This is what is plotted, this is what I have shown you. So it allows us to element identification, chemical state of the element, relative composition of the constituents, also valence band structure. All these things are possible. Well, I am not going to detail about that, but you can see that this is what I have been shown. This core level electron binding energy going to face Fermi level. From Fermi level, if you apply more energy, that is basically called, you know, the phi, and then it goes to vacuum level, and this is the theory. Or if it's same level spectrometer, actually that's how the spectrometer works. Then electron comes, it comes to Fermi level, there to Fermi level and spectrometer detectors. So therefore, binding energy is given by this equation. Second technique which you will discuss in detail is OGR. OGR is little bit different, which I will discuss now, than the but OGR has electrons comes from much lower surface depth than the XPS. Photoelectron spectroscopy based on a single photon in electron out process, and for many viewpoints it is very important. In XPS, that's what I have showed you. Okay, you have core electrons emitted and comes. In OGR, actually, what happens? You emit, you have a photoelectrons. Emit, so you have a photon coming, emit and core electrons, and these electrons actually hit another electron in the outer cell, and the electron from the outer cell get ejected. So therefore, the electron which is coming out because of this process has much lower kinetic energy, and therefore, it can only comes from the surface of the material. It cannot come much lower, larger depth. So therefore, exact surface probing is possible by using OGR. Okay, and this is and one can actually calculate the kinetic energy, binding energy of an electron, and then use it for many purposes. And that's what is done in OGR. And in SIMS, secondary ion mass electron, secondary ion mass spectroscopy is basically 30% mass spectroscopy. In SIMS, actually, what is used is basically a helium ion source, and this helium ion source then reject some ions inside the sample and we detect the mass of those ions, and that is why it is called secondary ion mass spectroscopy. And then it is used to basically measure what kind of mass of this ions which are coming out, and from that we can tell exactly the type of pieces present in the material, and that is how it is used. Anyway, so we are going to discuss in detail of each of this technique in the subsequent lectures.